Our next talk, I would like to stay there first. I would like to invite a wonderful man, a brilliant sonologist, Dr. Abhijeet Chury, who I'm fortunate works in the same place that I work, at Critical Hospital. Dr. Abhijeet Chury, please welcome. Abhijeet is a sonologist, and he, of course, he's a radiologist, but his specialty or his passion is sonology. Why is that, Abhijeet? Why not CT, MR, or simple plain X-rays?
Simply because it's operator dependent. I like to hunt things that people easily miss.
Okay, yeah. And I've seen him hunt things that people have missed so many times that I'm really glad that he is where I am. You can keep the mic a little up so that you're too tall. Why are you so tall? He's a brilliant athlete. He's a sports person. Unfortunately, gets little time for sports now that we have made him busy. Okay, this is how this lecture will go. The topic is, of course, ultrasonography for the generalist. And we are going to show you some cases where you become relevant. The job of the sonologist is to report. The job of the physician is to read the report correctly and find out what is missing and what is included in the report. How many of you know, I need a show of hands, how many of you know bad sonologists? Quite a few. Okay, what I'm asking is not to be derogatory to anybody, but the point is that all of us see bad lab reports, all of us see bad X-ray chest reporting, all of us see bad sonology reporting. The key is to how to find out what is lacking and how to interpret what is there. And this is the theme of this lecture. So every condition that we take, we'll be discussing what you should read from the report. Okay, so the first case, may we have the first slide, please? Abhijeet, this patient presented with acute epigastric pain radiating to the back with an acute fever and vomiting. A sonology was done. This is, of course, Abhijeet's patient, but and this is probably an inflamed pancreas. How will this report read to the physician?
Before I even start talking about pancreas, I would like to just point out a few things. When a patient reaches us, unless we know a good clinical picture about the picture, we don't start the study. I would be very glad if the clinician writes one or two points, or at least calls me up and tells me that, Abhijeet, I'm looking for abdominal pain. Give me some cause of pain. This guy has been suffering for 3 days or 4 days, vomiting, and I'll be very glad to help him, you know, more focus more on what he wants to see rather than looking everywhere. So clinical picture is very important. A sonologist or a radiologist without clinical history is just an imageologist. So imaging is very different from actually clinical ultrasound, which is what we do. Okay, like sir said, this is a pancreas. This is the uncinate process. The head. Sorry, this won't work. This is the body. Can I have another pointer, please? Sorry about that. So this would be the head of the pancreas, just about the SMV. This is the SMA, where the body of pancreas and the tail of pancreas. Now, why is it an inflamed pancreas? One, the most difficult organ to image is the pancreas. Why? One, because it's a retroperitoneal organ. Second, the stomach lies just anterior to the pancreas. So fasting, never. No fasting required for ultrasound, except for gallbladder. We'll come to that. An eco-poor pancreas, where the reflectivity of the pancreas is reduced, number one. Number two, an enlarged pancreas. So we have very specific markers in the size of pancreas. This is the head of the pancreas, which should not exceed 22 millimeters. Very specific. Number three, fluid around the pancreas. Very few other differentials will give fluid in pancreas, for example, dengue. Third, other inflammatory changes. Now, we spoke only about pancreas now. There are other areas to look for. For example, the paracolic gutters, where fluid will accumulate. Second, look for the cause of pancreatitis, like gallstones, or some abnormality with the CBD, like choledochocele, and of course, the history of alcohol comes. We are not going into other details.
So, basically, when the report comes to you, he will have written that the pancreas is edematous. Sometimes, however, there might not be a diagnosis of pancreatitis, even though the clinical suspicion is very strong. And therefore, we say that the gold standard test for pancreatitis is not an ultrasound.
CT.
What is the gold standard?
CT with contrast, yes.
When will you miss pancreatitis? Very early pancreatitis?
It is said that as soon as inflammatory exudates begin to come, ultrasound should pick it up. However, there are pitfalls in ultrasound. For example, an extremely obese patient, we will hardly be able to see the pancreas. You don't want to force this person to drink water because he's supposed to be NBM. So don't trouble this person with drinking more water, inducing more vomiting. Let him settle down. CT, if amylase lipase is elevated, will obviously be done. And that gives even a better picture of pancreatitis in the initial stages.
So if you have a patient who is very obese, say morbidly obese, and has taken alcohol, has come with what looks like acute pancreatitis, it may even be a better idea to send the patient directly for a CT scan with contrast rather than do an ultrasound, which is the gold standard test, the CT scan. Okay, let's go to the next slide, and very quickly, this slide shows normal pancreas and then pancreatitis with complications or propagation of the complications of pancreatitis. Anything to the GP in this?
So what to expect from an ultrasound report in pancreatitis? We've already established pancreatitis, one on ultrasound or CT by imaging, second by amylase serum lipase. Now, when we have to follow a patient who can't keep repeating a CT, obviously because of radiation and contrast-related complications, so an ultrasound is a very baseline, easily available test. We start seeing necrosis in about 48 hours later from the episode of pancreatitis. So this is an area, eco-poor area within the pancreas. You're seeing the pancreas to be really heterogeneous. It's not as smooth and bright as it was in a normal person. So this is the area of necrosis, which is not going to be perfused on a contrast CT, very easily picked up. This is going to be loculated. There'll be a pseudo wall formation and therefore a pseudocyst or a phlegmon when it gets infected. So this is how an evolution of pancreatitis you would see on ultrasound.
Correct. Let's go to the next case, which is cholelithiasis. This is, of course, the gallbladder, and you can see there's two stones there in the gallbladder. And you can see the acoustic shadows classically falling from the gallstones down, the black areas. This is a classic gallbladder. So when you have a patient who comes with gallstone colic, say pain after eating, lasting a couple of hours, going away, coming back, and there is no fever, no prolonged pain of more than 4 hours, you suspect gallstone colic, and you ask the patient to an ultrasound. This is one patient I think you will need fasting. And why is that?
Yeah, that's a good thing. So why do we need fasting as a positive indicator and a negative indicator? Is after fasting, after eating, the gallbladder normally contracts. A contract of gallbladder will reveal less number of pathologies. For example, wall thickening, polyps, a small stone stuck somewhere in the neck. You have something called the Phrygian cap deformity, which is extremely difficult to diagnose on an empty gallbladder. So fasting, absolutely important if you're suspecting gallstones. However, if the patient has eaten and we see a contracted gallbladder, it directly indicates an abnormality. So a contracted gallbladder on
fasting. If
fasting.
The patient has not eaten and
yes,
comes with a contracted
fasting.
Gallbladder.
It is an abnormal finding.
Correct. So in this situation, when will you be forced to send the patient for an ultrasound and can't wait for the next day for the patient to go fasting? When you think of acute cholecystitis, where you have the patient with, say, a febrile illness or a high WBC count, with pain more than 4 hours in duration, with right hypochondriac tenderness, with Murphy's positive, these patients you may not be able to wait for fasting on the next day. So you must send these. So that brings us to the next slide. Can you just comment on this, please?
In fact, I would like someone from the audience to talk if...
This, of course, shows a stone in the gallbladder. What is the feature of cholecystitis that you see here? Anybody? Wall thickening.
That's right.
Anything else?
Sorry?
Emphysema, no. There's no air.
Not in this patient.
There's fluid around the
pericholecystic fluid. Yes, this rim of fluid. Or this black line, yes.
That is fluid.
So that's as little as fluid that we need to diagnose. Okay? You won't see ml of fluid. You'll see milliliters of fluid. Really little. So when we come to cholecystitis as a complication of cholelithiasis or acalculus cholelithiasis, you will see three signs. One is a distended gallbladder. Second is a wall thickening. And third is a pericholecystic inflammatory process, which not only includes fluid, but includes inflamed fat as well. A good sonologist will pick up fat stranding even before CT does. So these three signs. Once you see pathology in the gallbladder, do not stop to see the CBD. CBD is the next most important point, because before the patient goes for surgery, we need to tell the physician or surgeon that the CBD is clean, one from calculi, second from infection. Okay?
Correct. Takes us to the next topic, which is another acute condition. And this is the kidney. And this is an extreme case of pyelonephritis. Now, an ultrasound is ordered by us commonly in patients with acute febrile illness with urinary tract symptoms, especially the patient in diabetic. We'll be asking for an ultrasound to rule out pyelonephritis. Can you please comment on how will this be reported to the chief?
Yes. The first and foremost point in a pyelonephritic kidney is the size. No kidney should exceed 12 centimeters in length in an adult. No kidney should extend 12 centimeters in length. So if this is more than 12, it's abnormal. Okay, I'm not saying it's directly pyelonephritis. Second feature is dilatation of the PCS. The pelvis as well as the calyces are dilated. Okay, that's the second feature. Third feature, if you can see it clearly, the urothelium is thickened. Look at this. You generally don't see the urothelium separately. It's just a fine line. Here you're seeing a thickening. Third, obviously you're seeing echoes. You're seeing these pus flakes within the dilated system. So dilatation of the PCS is because of?
What causes dilatation in pyelonephritis of the pelvic calyceal system?
Reflux. Okay. Anything else? More obvious?
Obstruction due to what?
So urethritis is the most common cause.
Inflammation of the ureter due to infection.
It's never an isolated pyelonephritis. There's some amount of involvement of the ureter. So along with renal signs, we also see perirenal signs. Some amount of fluid around the kidney, also seen in hydronephrosis, acute hydronephrosis. You will see some amount of perinephric fluid and fat stranding again.
Okay. The next condition that we see is this. This patient is a young male who has come with extremely severe loin to groin left-sided pain, and you send the patient for an ultrasound and you see this stone there. Which part of the ureter would that be?
This is the upper ureter. This would be the PU junction at the level of lower pole, and this is the upper ureter. So this is where I would like to stress the need for a full bladder. We understand that the patient with acute ureteric colic cannot drink a lot of water, has dysuria, will pass urine more frequently, cannot hold. However, in such cases, the exact diagnosis, location and size of stones or calculi is very difficult. In case where the ureter is traced till the lower part, a transvaginal or transrectal ultrasound 100% would diagnose the condition. Why I'm stressing on the location and size of the calculi, because the treatment will definitely vary. A large calculus would not be expected to pass with medication, would need some surgical intervention.
So what he's saying is, if the patient cannot retain oral water, then there is an option of doing a transrectal or transvaginal ultrasound for ureteric stones to
lower ureteric calculi.
For lower ureteric stones to locate and size the stones. what size can pass?
Usually around 5 to 6 is what we are confident about, up to 5 to 6.
Okay. And there is a difference between the size measured on ultrasound and the size measured
yes.
on CT.
Yes, this is a good question. Why is that so? Because we image in a single plane, while CT or MR would has a multiplanar approach. So the longest diameter that we see may not be the longest diameter of the calculus. As the stone passes down, sometimes the angle of the calculus might change. And today, if I have reported a 5 millimeter, tomorrow it might become 7 millimeters. That should not come as a surprise. Secondly, why a lower uretric calculus is important, why a transvaginal transrectal is because of uretric abnormalities. We have seen so many uretroceles being missed, and a calculus is not expected to come out of uretrocele without surgical intervention. So these important, small important points are to be kept in mind.
So can you diagnose a renal stone or uretric stone in a patient who is not full bladder and has a lot of, say, gas in the abdomen? Can you diagnose? Suppose you send a patient for ultrasound KUB and the radiosonologist sends him back, ki full bladder nahi hai, gas bahut hai, and you are strongly suspecting a uretric stone clinically. What you can call up the sonologist and do is just tell him that I know that the patient cannot hold urine, is vomiting, but I need to know some circumstantial evidence. And what circumstantial evidence which will be apparent even without full bladder? I don't know.
Correct.
So you can still think of sending the patient for ultrasound without full bladder and look for hydronephrosis as an indirect evidence of an obstruction. Is that correct?
That's perfect.
Okay. We go to the next slide, please. This patient is a female, 40-year-old, who comes with dysuria and frequency of urine. This is the urinary bladder, and you see the thickened wall of the urinary bladder. We don't often send all uncomplicated UTIs, especially in females. In males, the rule is to do an ultrasound, but in females, we may not see, especially first episode. So when you find this kind of thickened wall, what are we looking at? Is it chronic,
first of all,
recurrent?
The clinician wants to know whether it's an infective type of cystitis or it's a obstructive cause of thickening of the wall. So a smooth thickened wall more than 3 millimeters when it's distended, and more than 5 millimeters when it's a contracted bladder. By distension, I mean we need at least 180 ml of urine to call it a distended bladder. Most people with such type of thickened bladders will not be able to retain urine. So it's no point making them wait and filling up their bladders. So one, the most important part is the thickened wall, smooth surface, no trabeculations. And one easy thing a radiologist can always do is do a postvoid. So you come to know straight away there whether she's passing urine or not. Another thing we'll see is some echoes inside, some debris, again indicating pus cells or higher counts in the urine.
So what you're saying is that the thickened wall could be due to cystitis or it could be due to
bladder outlet obstruction.
Obstruction causing muscle to be
muscle hypertrophy. Yes.
And that appears as a thickening of the gallbladder wall. Okay.
So pseudodiverticulae, calculi formation, all those reflux as
can cause thickened. Okay. We go to the next film. That is we don't have a film here. I just wanted to bring with the bladder there, the ultrasound of BPH, and how to ask for an ultrasound by the GP. So when you have a patient who comes with LUTS, lower urinary tract symptoms, and you send the patient for an ultrasound, you must, as in every other case, you must write specifically what you require. So when you write, okay, I want USG KUB with prostate with PVR, that is a must, so that the PVR is not missed by the sonologist. And also, if you write prostate, he might be tempted to do a transrectal if he finds something marginal. So when will you do a transrectal for the prostate?
So transrectal is the most accurate method of calculating the size of prostate. Number one, seminal vesicles, some anatomical variations within the prostate. Two, when the PSA is elevated, you want to differentiate between a BPH and a malignant disease, or a focal prostatic abscess, which will never be picked up on a transabdominal ultrasound. One. Secondly, when you said KUB with PVR and all that, once a physician writes KUB, it's a radiologist's job to see the postvoid, to see the prostate, whether it's mentioned or not. You don't actually need to. I don't know which sort of doctors don't do it, but KUB means prostate and postvoid residue.
Correct.
So it doesn't have to be separately.
Separately mentioned, okay. And you said malignancy. How do you look make out malignancy on ultrasound?
So as obscure as the breast cancer, ultrasound will hardly ever pick up prostatic malignancies. Only when you're suspecting a heterogeneous pancreas, only biopsy, USG guided biopsy is the next step. Ultrasound will never ever give you that this is a malignant lesion, like other imaging investigations.
Correct. What is the normal ultrasound size? They report often volume or size.
So grade 1 prostate, which is the normal prostate, is around 20 to 30 grams. 30 to 50 grams is grade 1. 50 to 80 grams becomes grade 3. And grade 4 is more than 80 grams.
Sorry, I didn't get the grades properly.
20 to 30 is the normal range, which is grade 1. 30 to 50 is grade 2. 50 to 80 is grade 3. And grade 4 is above 80 grams.
Okay. And sometimes they are reported as grams, sometimes as cc or ml.
So when you calculate grams, you multiply the volume into 0.52.
So the comparison between ml and grams is?
Multiply by 0.52.
Grams is lesser than ml.
The volume, I think it's the volume. Sorry, I made a mistake.
So in ml, they give the volume.
So the specific gravity is 1.1.
Sorry?
Specific gravity of prostate is 1.1. Oh, so you multiply the volume into 1.1. So grams is slightly similar
to each other. Okay. So some radiologists will give a report as ml. Some will give as grams. I frankly have never thought that they were different. I always took them as same. But as he rightly said, the difference might be only 10% or so. So the same classification of 20 to 30 grams, 30 to 50, and 50 to 80, etc., will hold here also. Okay. We go on to the next. And this is an ultrasound of a male who presented with high grade fever, severe rigors, WBC of 18,000, and right hypochondriac pain with shock tenderness and a palpable liver. And your clinical diagnosis was amoebic liver abscess, and you sent the patient for an ultrasound. Can you just tell us what will be this be reported as?
Yes. So, primary hepatic lesions or single hepatic lesions, usually when it's a cystic area containing fluid, either it's thick fluid or it's thin fluid, there will be a posterior acoustic enhancement. You will see this segment of liver showing more echoes, becoming brighter than the normal. It's a artifact which is useful to us, indicating it's a cystic cavity. Okay, that's one. Second, it's slightly easy to differentiate between amoebic and pyogenic abscesses. One, because amoebic abscesses are eco-poor or darker on ultrasound, while they're more single as well. The pyogenic abscesses are more echogenic. They are brighter than the normal liver panchroma, and they seem to be multifocal. They usually cluster around each other. That's two. So from an ultrasound, you would like to know a few things. One is the size of the liver. An amoebic hepatitis would always, the liver would always be a little larger, the normal range being up to 15 centimeters. So anything beyond 15 centimeters in an adult is enlarged. What criteria I use is when the lower pole of the right lobe crosses the lower pole of the right kidney, it's always enlarged. There's no need to look at size as well.
Upper pole of right kidney and the lower border of the liver.
Liver. Secondly, these focal lesions, how do you characterize these focal lesions? We always have a Doppler with us. So on B mode, it's little, it might be sometimes a dicey, you can miss a cystic malignancy or a cystic metastasis from somewhere. Put in a color Doppler. There won't be any color pickup or any Doppler images within the lesion. The walls are edematous and vascular, so the walls will show some hyperemia. Otherwise, it's a very classical picture. Second thing we see in amoebic abscesses is usually typhlitis or ascending colitis. It's a telltale sign that this is where the infection has come from.
As you know, amoebic liver abscess often, the source is the colonic amoebiasis, and typhlitis is the term used for cecal inflammation. So either typhlitis or ascending colitis may be reported by the sonologist telling you, okay, this looks like amoebic and not pyemic abscess. One more question here. One of the commonest lesions seen in the liver, space occupying lesion, is the hemangioma.
Correct.
Now, often you will read reports telling you that there are hemangiomas in the liver, and these are what? To be considered clinically significant or no?
Insignificant, absolutely.
Clinically insignificant. And they would, you look hypoechoic or hyperechoic?
Hyper. They have a lot of cell walls. Correct. Within. So they reflect most of the sound waves. And secondly, you will see normal vessels traversing through them. That is one sign. So hemangioma.
So multiple white-colored round lesions, most common form is a hemangioma, which is normal. Okay, we go on to the last adult picture. And anybody? This is an endovaginal ultrasound showing the right ovary on this side. What is seen here? What is the diagnosis?
That's right. So usually we'll have patients presenting with bleeding PVs. They will not come with periods of amenorrhea. That's how the ectopics present. A gynec would send you a patient with abdominal pain or a deep pelvic pain with a short span of amenorrhea and bleeding. So pain is a presenting feature in...
Even in unruptured?
Even in unruptured, okay. Because of the distension of the tubes. What you're seeing, what you're seeing here is this is the uterus with endometrial thickening or the decidual reaction. Now, usually the decidual reaction is absolutely white. It should be bright and homogeneous. You're seeing a lot of cystic areas within the endometrium, meaning the corpus luteum is failing. The beta HCG is not enough to hold the corpus luteum. Secondly, you're seeing an extra uterine gestational sac with a fetus showing cardiac activity. This is the sign for ectopic. We usually don't wait for cardiac activity to come. This rim, this thin rim, also called the fire sign, is enough for us to diagnose. Usually the yolk sac appears by 5 weeks. So we don't need to wait for the CRL or the fetal pole to come. So a decidual reaction with an extra uterine gestational sac, ectopic. Don't wait for hemoperitoneum.
Rupture to occur. Okay. I'll now ask Dr. Tushar Maniar to come up and he will quiz you for a few more minutes.
Hi.
Hello.
Thank you, Tushar. So we have enough of adult stuff. Again, as we said, this is adult versus pediatrician. So what is the commonest indication that you would ask an ultrasound in pediatric age group? UTI, very good, excellent. Thank you. So, when would you ask it in a hurry or in emergency? Acute abdomen, excellent. So let's start with acute abdomen. Dr. Abhijeet, can you tell us what things would you look for in a child who comes with acute abdomen? And I mean, you know, classically they'll come with periumbilical pain. Not necessarily, they may have not yet localized to a particular area in the abdomen. So,
yes.
Highlight.
Now, specifically coming to this case, as sir said, the localizing signs are very difficult in children clinically. However, the presentation in my clinical practice I've seen always appear with epigastric pain. So, never ever not look at the right iliac fossa in children. This is a classical appendix. Not only a thick walled but a distended appendix. You're seeing an appendicolith with a shadowing. You are also seeing some fluid along the mesentery. This is the inflamed white bright mesentery. So this is a classical appendix. The size of the or the thickness of the appendix needs to be more than 7 millimeters to call it inflamed.
What are the situations in which we would suspect appendicitis? Send you, we are pretty sure, but ultrasound report will come back saying, sorry, I can't see or I'm not sure. Or
yes, so this specifically refers to the placement, the location of the appendix. Retrocecal appendix, a very difficult task for radiologist. Although in children, it's not such a difficult thing because the abdomen is not that big. The muscles are not that thick for us to use a high-frequency probe. However, in bigger children, once the abdominal fat and the muscle develop. The cecum, sometimes it's loaded, sometimes because of the inflammation, there's a paralytic ileus, and the gas shadow is persistently there. There's no harm in writing that the cecal shadow is persistently there and the appendix or the right iliac fossa is not clearly visualized. You will sometimes see secondary signs like inflamed mesentery or very minimal fluid. You can also elicit a probe tenderness in that area. So you can call up your physician and give him these signs that although I'm not directly seeing the appendix, there is some inflammatory pathology there in the right iliac fossa.
What would you, can you highlight about what is fats trending or what do we see by omentum covering, etc.? We do get some reports.
Yes. So now these are actually CT signs which ultrasound has now started seeing. Now omentum is basically fat that connects the appendix and other bowel with the mesentery. This fat usually is eco-poor, just like this fat, okay? Peritoneal fat, it is supposed to be eco-poor or not have many reflectivities within it. Once fluid starts seeping, the inflammatory fluid and the vessels start, because of the vasculitis, you will see edema or increased reflectivity. This is fat stranding. This is edema or fat stranding of the mesentery.
But many times when we send a patient for acute appendicitis or for any abdominal pain, not necessarily suspecting acute appendicitis, we get a report which says non-specific mesenteric lymphadenitis. So can you tell us how to interpret that?
Now, this is a very common presentation, especially in children around 3 to 5 years of age. These kids will typically present with right-sided abdominal pain on and off. They might be constipated. These kids will show these lymph nodes, multiple mesenteric lymph nodes, showing a normal hilum. You can see the hilum, the flow going through the hilum, and the size not exceeding 1.5 centimeters. Multiple such nodes. At the most, you might see mild ileal thickening, mild ileal, not even moderate. So isolated mesenteric lymph nodes not exceeding 1.5 centimeters, showing a normal morphology, along with mild ileitis. That is the presentation of non-specific mesenteric adenitis.
So we shouldn't be worrying really about a subcentric or subcentimeter, as it's called,
no.
Lymph nodes, provided no. There are no other abdominal
That's right.
abnormalities noted on sonogram. Thank you. What do we see in children with, is there anything specific that you see in dengue or in enteric fever, any peculiarities that you would see on ultrasound?
Yeah, now, according to me, enteric is quite easy to diagnose on ultrasound, even without a clinical or a blood picture. These kids will present with predominantly ileal mesentery-related lymph nodes, which are not matted. They will not have any necrosis. These lymph nodes are oval in shape. They are around 2 centimeters in longest diameter. This is one form. Second presenting part is the ileal lymphoid hyperplasia, which is very classical in typhoid. We have all learned this in pathology. So ileal lymphoid hyperplasia classically looks like a black band along the distal ileum or terminal ileum. Some of these kids, we have even demonstrated ulcers. Air bubbles get trapped within the mucosa along the lymphoid hyperplasia, where you can pick up ulcerations. Hepatosplenomegaly, obviously, yes. So these 4 points in a febrile patient usually points towards enteric fever.
Thank you. So we will let Dr. Abhijeet diagnose enteric fever on sonology, right?
But you also mentioned.
All of us will definitely diagnose enteric fever in another way, which we will be discussing in the next lecture.
Dengue is one more thing you asked me about.
Sure.
So a hepatitis, a slightly enlarged liver, edematous liver, mild splenomegaly, serositis in the form of bilateral small effusions, maybe mild to even moderate ascites, no peritoneal thickening. However, what is classical in dengue ascites is that there are septations. There are fine fibrotic septations, not only in the ascites, but even around the kidneys, the perinephric fluid that we see. You'll see fine septations. You'll also see a gross gallbladder wall edema because of the inflamed liver, as well as the hyperproteinemia that comes with dengue.
So this is what we're talking about, acute abdomen or abdominal pain. Now many times we have, not many times, but once in a while you will have a child which you will come with abdominal pain. On examination, abdomen will be reasonably soft, but the child will be doing something like, oh, oh. and you suddenly decide, okay, maybe I need to look beyond the abdomen, and you examine the genitals, you find either a swelling of the testes, or sometimes even if you find the testes which are up, and normally the testes are placed vertically. That means the long axis is vertical. But if you clinically see the testes which are lying horizontally, that could be the first and the early sign for torsion testes, and it's very important to pick up at that point. You have to decide and operate urgently. So, Dr. Abhi, please tell us, what do we look for on sonography?
Now, not every case is classical, not every picture is as clean as this. What we generally see is, luckily we have the other testes to compare. An edematous testes, an enlarged testes, is the first finding. So clinical dilemma is always between acute orchitis versus torsion. This is where our role comes. And when you ask for an ultrasound, it does not limit us to an ultrasound. We have to use Doppler in every case. You don't have to specifically write for do a Doppler, only then we'll put on the Doppler machine. No. This is an important part of ultrasound. You will see the normal testes showing normal perfusion, the red indicating, the red color indicates what? Arteries?
Yeah.
And blue veins. Okay, so it's just a convention that we use. The RBCs that move towards the probe are marked red, and that away from the probe are marked blue. You can easily reverse this polarity, and it is just used as a guiding line for us. So this is the testes showing an ecotexture, which is normal to the liver. We always compare all ecotextures to the liver. This is an edematous testes. Okay, it's an enlarged testes. If you see, the axis of the testes also changed. You are not seeing any flow within the testes at all, at the same setting as the other testes. You are seeing the marker here. This box is the Doppler box. You are seeing the Doppler markings here. So if you don't see flow, it is the first sign. It's the most obvious sign, of course. B mode or ultrasound without color Doppler, the signs that I told you, an enlarged edematous testes, you will see fuzzy markings along the wall, that is also edema. And most important, you will see a twisted cord in children. So you can easily trace the cord into the funica. Look for the whirlpool sign. You will see a twisting happening over there. When the twisting is less than 360 degrees, usually the venous flow is occluded. So there's some amount of flow on power Doppler, low Doppler imaging. But once the degree of torsion increases beyond 360 degrees, even the arterial flow is stopped. So you'll see an edematous or a gangrenous testes. You need to operate this guy.
So apart from torsion, which other condition would come? What is the closest differential that you would say?
Acute epididymal orchitis. Sorry?
Viral orchitis in pediatrics, not so common. Acute epididymal orchitis, commonly we need to rule out tuberculosis and acute bacterial also. Yeah, but that doesn't present as
unilateral.
Equivalent unilateral and torsion testes. What we are asking is not just swelling of testes, but a differential diagnosis of torsion testes.
So in acute epididymal orchitis, you will see increased flow in the affected testes rather than reduced flow. That's one point.
Before we go to the next topic, one message that if you happen to see a patient where you don't have access to ultrasound and you're suspecting torsion testes, please don't wait for a sonologist to do it. Refer to the surgeon urgently and please tell the surgeon on phone that I'm suspecting torsion testes. Okay? Few hours can make a difference between saving that testes and not saving that. Now you have another child, who young infant, who comes with excessive crying or comes with dullness. Whenever you have altered sensorium with abdominal pain or cramping, please think about intussusception. Don't wait for blood, mucus and red currant jelly. Our children, by the time they pass red currant jelly, you may be late in managing an intussusception. So the most important and urgent investigation is intussusception. Could you tell us how to do an ultrasound?
So of the many pathologies in pediatrics, this is the most commonly missed pathology. Most of them will give a normal report because you don't have any secondary signs. You may not get a bowel dilatation initially. What you need to look is for a short segment of bowel, the intersusceptum entering the intersuscepiens. You may not find a leading point, especially in pediatrics. Usually in adults, we'll find a lymph node or you will find a polyp. Lymphoid hyperplasia might be the only other thing that you might find in the affected bowel. So these short segments of intersusception, like you're seeing, it's a really, really short segment. Put on the color. You'll see good blooming flow into the omentum, into the wall of the vessels, indicating it's a fresh intersusception. Sometimes these are reducible on their own. You don't need to do anything. You just need to observe them, give them fluid diet. And the further stages of intersusception, being a longer segment, or ischemia starting with venous and arterial, and going on to gangrene. The commonest site in children being IC junction, or ileo-ileocolic, then ileo-ileal and colocolic. So RIF is a Pandora's box. You always find a lot of things there. We discussed appendix, we discussed mesenteric lymph nodes, now into susception.
We also sometimes get reports of saying worms seen. I'm sure none of us send for sonologists for diagnosis of worms, do we?
Yes, it's so usually an incidental finding, and you really have to look for them. You can't just find them. Use a high frequency probe. A fluid filled small bowel, usually, which you see in children, will reveal these long structures. Sometimes you can see air within the bowel of the worms. Okay, you can see wriggling movements. These are all round worms.
That's good. Thank you. So we come to the last point of discussion is, as you said, right iliac fossa is Pandora's box, and TB is always an enigma for all of us. So can you tell us different presentations of abdominal cox in children?
Yes, the most common being lymph nodes. Now, this case especially, you'll see oval rim lymph nodes with small echopore areas. If you remember the lymph node that I saw in the last slide, the non-specific mesenteric, it had a hilum, and it had preserved the corticomedullary junction, just like the kidney.
Could you just here, quickly go back and show
yes.
and we can come back again?
Yeah. You're seeing the fatty hilum. You're seeing the vessels diverging from here. You're seeing a echopore cortex, and you're seeing the medulla. Now you can compare it. This is almost oval. It's not reniform anymore. You're also seeing secondary small peritoneal nodules. You're seeing the fat or peri-adenitis, abnormal fat along the lymph nodes. These are peritoneal nodules, smaller than 2 or 3 millimeters. This is one presentation of tuberculosis in child. The second being peritonitis. You will see peritoneal thickening. This is the parietal peritoneal thickening. You will see fluid as a reactive process. You will see tiny nodules along the peritoneum thickening. Other presentations like organ involvements, you can see splenic microabscesses. You can see ileocecal thickening or bowel thickening in children.
So we all know that saturation or oxygen probes have become a fourth clinical sign for all of us. And ultrasound is becoming a extension of our clinical examination. And thank you, Dr. Abhijeet Chury, for giving us an insight into the sonology.
Thank you so much.
Another round of applause, please. Thank you so much. Thank you. Okay, we are a little short of time, so we'll quickly go to the next session. First of all, is Dr. Sanjay Arora still here? Yeah, Dr. Sanjay, please acknowledge the audience's applause for you. Dr. Sanjay Arora is the pathologist, of course, and the CEO of Suburban Diagnostics. And besides, of course, sponsoring partly the event, they have been of great academic input to the whole conference. And I really thank you. One input that he just gave me in the morning after our first Q versus A is, that serum iron, he corrected me, is not to be done fasting, as we already said, but must be done in the morning because of the diurnal variation of iron, like cortisol. So morning iron, though not fasting. Dr. Sanjay, thank you so much for everything that you have been doing for us so far.